Labrīt, visiem, kas
Good morning, everybody. Those who have gathered today for the event supported by the fund New Direction.
Use a direct interpretation, but I will speak Latvian on introduction report, so please use your headphones. And the same of during all the conference, we have two languages all the time. A new direction outbound.
So this event is supported by the fund New Direction. And today we would like to speak about a very important issue that might cause and actually is causing certain problems in a single market, namely the social dumping. It is used sometimes as a protectionist measure, protecting local markets, local interests, but in today's conference we'll try to find eventual solutions for this phenomenon and to describe situations that might cause even bigger problems for the internal market. In my opening speech, I would like to remind about an example of a Polish plumber who helped to adopt a constitutional agreement, but now this Polish plumber has turned into a Romanian lorry driver. But I think we remember also the case in Latvia about service providers of one member state into another member state, and that was about the construction workers. This summer, we faced Brexit, and I will say in English.
Jobs away. O kas varēja būt par vienu no galvenajiem iemesliem.
This could be one of the reasons why it happened what happened. And I remember one hearing in the European Parliament in the beginning of this year where we were speaking about the social dumping in the transport sector. And one of the leaders of the trade union said, imagine that in the cargo of Antwerp, Portuguese lorry driver takes our cargoes. Can you imagine that? Then I remember one of the discussions with my colleagues in the Transport Committee in European Parliament. Can you imagine that in Lufthansa there are Bulgarian pilots on the plane, in the cockpit? Then I would like to remind one more thing about the service area. And if we remember four basic freedoms like free movement of goods, labor, capital, and people, and if in the area of goods this market is operating more or less acceptably, and before Brexit the UK Treasury survey proved that the market of goods without the single market would be, the turnover of these goods would be by 75% lower. However, in the service sector, they claim that this difference without single market would constitute only 16%. So it means that the major benefit we are enjoying can be found in the goods sector, in the sales. And then in the beginning of 2015, German government adopted the law concerning the lorry drivers and the fines imposed on the cargo companies. And then, thanks to the major pressure both from the Council and European Parliament, the European Commission initiated the investigation procedure, which has not finished yet, and I'm afraid that it will not be completed before the elections in government. And then in October, there was a law adopted in France, and that was also about certain provisions to be applied in the transport sector. And then I would like to remind you that if we speak about the cabotage services, this market is not open yet, and it does not help single market. And then I would like to remind that there's a new version of the posting of workers directive prepared, and there are some aspects which are quite unclear at the moment, especially if we speak about drivers or workers in the transport sector providing services between member states. Then it means that the different rates of minimum wage would apply to a single ride if that ride goes through several member states. Can you imagine this mess then? And then if we take into account global developments, what might happen with the TTIP, with the Transatlantic Free Trade Agreement, what's happening with the Pacific Agreement, and what happens in the European single market, we are on a kind of crossroads between being open and being closed. For me, as an economist, I believe that being open is always better than being closed. But unfortunately, in realpolitik, sometimes being closed takes the upper hand. But I believe that this is viable only in short term, and this is a danger that might lead us in completely wrong direction in further developing this single market, which now comprises 500 million people, which probably after the Brexit will be smaller. Well, if we speak about our GDP, for example, of course, it's one of the lowest. But these four basic freedoms allow us to catch up more advanced countries. And any restrictions, starting from allowances, from the travel allowances to the EP, the European Members of Parliament, for example, there we see differences because I receive different pay than my Danish colleagues. Or, for example, Bulgarian MEP can employ 11 assistants for the same pay as would be for one assistant for a Danish MEP. And this shows that it requires political willingness. And I believe that social dumping is very interesting phenomenon, which is manipulated sometimes by left-hand parties or extreme right-wing parties, even sometimes. It can be misused, of course. Well, that was a short opening. I would like to thank everybody who has arrived today, and I would like to introduce our speakers for the first panel. The second panel also will be very interesting, and you will have a chance to ask questions. And I wish all of us a very successful conference. Those who are following us on the internet, those who were not able to arrive today, I'm glad that you have this opportunity. And I see also Roman Snaudinch, who is the head of the European Latvian Parliament's Committee on Industry Issues. And there are also representatives of the road transport trade union here. And now I would like to introduce our first speaker, Mr. Zsolt Darvas.
Working in Brussels, in Bruegel, it's a very well-known think tank, actually on many issues, but he's Hungarian, of course, as you see by his name, and he has a long experience in research, mainly in very many areas, but of course very much related with economics and financial matters. He was working in Central Bank of Hungary, and he used to be a visiting research. He held research positions in the Bank of Finland, Deutsche Bank, the Netherlands Bank, Stockholm School of Economics, and so on. So I think it would be a very interesting presentation, and then we will have a time for questions. So, Zsolt, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, European Parliament member Zilla, for inviting me here, and also for your very kind introduction. Now, the title of my presentation is Social Dumping and Posted Workers. But I will try to argue during my presentation that the expression social dumping is a very badly defined and a very negative expression. And if you try to understand what it really means, we will find it really, really hard. I also read the very nice work of Magdalena, and I also refer to it, so probably she will help us to clarify. But from my side, I have to say, I find this expression very inappropriate. Now, but why do we talk about this issue at all? I think many of you in the room know that posting of workers means offering a service in another European Union country for a temporary period and posting workers to another EU country for this temporary period. And since the late 1990s, there is a Posted Workers Directive, which regulates what are the key provisions for such employment of posted workers. The debate on this issue has been ongoing, ever since the directive has been agreed. And in 2012, a new discussion started on the implementation of the directive. And an enforcement directive was agreed, which came into force in 2014, so it was quite recent. And at that time, I think the discussion was exclusively focused on the social rights of posted workers. Even I looked at the European Trade Union Confederation's comments at that time. And that time, nobody wanted to call for the so-called same pay or equal pay. But President Juncker probably received demand from some member states to put this issue on his agenda. So in 2014, he set the goal, which let me read the quote, that in our union, the same work at the same place should be remunerated in the same manner. And certainly this sparked a major debate among all stakeholders, between member states, different organizations, and so on. And since, President Juncker set this goal, something had to be done. And I think while they were working on this issue, they realized that this same pay principle simply cannot be achieved. I will talk a little bit later. But still, the Commission had to deliver something. And in March this year, the Commission proposed some amendments to the Posted Workers Directive, which were criticized from all sides. So those who are in favor of the same pay principle, they criticized the proposal for not being sufficiently ambitious. By those who had the opposite view, arguing that the current directive is sufficient and the key problem is its enforcement, they criticized that adding further administrative burden and further complications for posting of workers, this will in fact at the end limit the free flow of services within the European Union, and by limiting that, it will have negative impact on everything on economic growth and employment and everything. Just on the procedure, there was a so-called yellow card procedure whereby national parliaments could raise a reasoned opinion on whether this proposed amendment is in line with the subsidiarity principle of the EU, and 14 parliaments have raised such objections. But in a July document, the European Commission concluded that these objections do not rest on solid ground, and they kept the same proposal as before. So now negotiations will start, and I expect a very long and difficult negotiation, which it's difficult to see what will come at the end. But I would like to, in my presentation, go back a little bit back a step further and basically try to answer three questions. One is how important are posted workers in influencing the jobs and social conditions in high-wage hosting member states? The second question is whether the revision of this posted workers directive is the right way to address concerns. And the third is what is the elephant in the room? Now, if some of you have already read my work, then you know that I think undeclared work, and I will show you, is 100 times more important than possible abuses of posted workers. But so let me go in this order. But first, some background. I would like to start by saying that all kinds of economic integration has an impact on labor. Even if you trade with China, that has an impact on labor, because from China or Vietnam, we can import goods. We don't import any people. I mean, in a sense, there is no posting from, or I mean, they're governed by different rules, but in general, there are no very limited service providers from China in Europe. But we import a lot of goods, and since these goods are produced with cheap labor in China, Vietnam, Bangladesh, and in other Asian countries, even if there is no, you know, deep integration like in the EU, labor is heavily involved because, you know, many European companies, what they are doing, they are saying that wages are much higher here than in China or Vietnam. So they offshore their activities to these countries and produce there and import the goods back to Europe, which means that jobs are lost in the EU. And thereby, through the imported goods, we are importing practically cheap labor. But this is not really visible to everyone, because if you go to a shop and buy whatever toy or whatever and it's written made in China, you are happy that it is cheaper, but you don't really see that at the end, you know, this is, I mean, this import product is actually lowering employment in the European Union. But we have, when we have deep integration, then certainly it's much more visible. So, I mean, trading goods is also here. So if you look at, for example, the European Union, I will show you shortly a chart on trade. Also, there are trading services, and since this is the role of the single market to foster cross-border provision of various kind of activities, including services. And if a service provider is there, then certainly the labor is there. You know, if an IT company comes here and you know, fixes that and whatever IT problem, then an IT expert comes here for a few months. Or if a construction company, a Polish company, builds something in Germany, then construction worker is posted there. So the persons are physically present, and in my view, that's the reason why, one key reason why the posted worker issue receives such prominence. But also, there is a lot of FDI, and we all know that there was a major offshoring from Germany and other major European Union countries to the new member states of the EU. And they moved a lot of production here. So when we have this deep integration, then labor is even more involved. So the bottom line or the takeaway that a kind of labor mobility or impact of labor condition is always present. But the question whether it is direct by, you know, posting a worker or indirect by importing goods from China or Latvia or Latin America. And also the question whether it's temporary or permanent. You know, posted worker is a temporary issue, why, you know, labor mobility is more permanent issue, and also offshoring is more permanent. Now, we all know that wages and prices across countries are vary a lot with the level of economic development. If you compare, for example, wages in the EU, just, let's say, hourly wages, and what we see is that in Bulgaria, which has the lowest wage, and you compare Denmark, and in Denmark, wages are 10 times more. So basically, in nominal terms, in euro terms, or whatever terms, there are huge wage differences in the EU. And you know, that has very good reasons. I mean, economic research has well established that in more productive countries, people earn more. In less productive countries, people earn less. So I think that, in principle, that's nothing, not a problem with that. But you know, the problem which comes to the fore, that let's say if a Bulgarian worker is posted to Denmark, then that worker will be super happy to, let's say, work at the Danish minimum wage, which will be still many times more than what he or she could earn at home in Sofia. But at the same time, you know, Danish companies see a competition coming from, let's say, Bulgarian service providers, that they have an advantage that they pay lower wages. So I think that's one direct channel which is really observable. But as I already mentioned, you know, if there is no posting at all, but we, you know, the Danish, you know, retailer imports wine or whatever from Bulgaria, again, the same cheap labor is imported. Or if the Danish company offshores its production to Bulgaria, then again, jobs are taken away, more competition in the EU. So I would like to emphasize that there are three major factors, and I will argue that posted worker is the one and far the least important. So now let me show you some data. So this chart shows just the composition of the share of imports of goods of core EU countries. Under the core EU countries, I mean the first 15 members of the EU, with the exception of Greece, Portugal, and Spain. And what you can see here is that, I mean, the new member states are this orange line. So you can see that their share in imports was less than 5% and grew to 10%. So basically, 10% of total imports are now from Central Eastern Europe, which is really a lot. So if you calculate how many euros, I don't know by heart, but it's several dozen or 100 billion euros imported each year. And that involves a lot of cheap labor. But if you look at this line in the top, you know, emerging and developing countries in total, so that's here we use an IMF data set which includes all countries, you know, almost one third of imports in the EU 15 countries are coming from emerging and developing countries where wages are much, much lower than in the EU. So through the imports of goods, you know, Europe imports a lot of cheap labor, which, as I said, not directly visible because, you know, the worker in Vietnam is not present in Paris. But in fact, it is exactly the same. We import a lot of cheap labor. Now, the next chart shows offshoring, which, you know, is a very tricky issue how to measure it. So the measure I adopted here from another study looks at what is the share of intermediate inputs to production, what is the share of these intermediate inputs coming from different parts of the world. And again, you can see, unfortunately, for the EU, we have all the 13 Central European countries. I also did here Malta and Cyprus for the sake of simplicity. But for emerging countries, and we all included China, India, Indonesia, Brazil, and Mexico. It's a very limited sample. But still, what you can see here, that it's really going up. So even in the crisis, there was not much change. So clearly, offshoring is continuing. So companies, let's say, in Germany or France or Belgium continue to offshore more and more production to both Central and Eastern Europe and to Asia and other parts of the world. So clearly, again, it is a huge import of cheap labor, which is not really visible. Now let me come to posting of workers. You know, data are always thought to be not really reliable, but certainly, I mean, if a company posts, it has to, you know, declare it. So hopefully the data is not completely wrong, even if not complete. And this figure, which I just simply take from the European Commission impact assessment, which accompanied the March proposal, shows what is the share of total number of posted workers from different wage groups. So from high wage to high wage, let's say from France to Germany, you can see that about one third, a bit more than one third, from low wage to high wage, which is a key concern. That's also about one third. There's also medium to high, let's say from the medium wage countries are Cyprus, Spain, Greece, Malta, Slovenia, and Portugal. It's about 15%, but certainly that's less of a problem. But there's also high to low. You know, Danish companies also post workers in Bulgaria. But the bottom line of this chart, which I think is a very telling and nice chart, is that only one third of total posted workers go from low wage countries to high wage countries. Now, please remember this one third number. And the next in this slide, I try to make a back of the envelope estimate on how many of these low wage posted workers, what could their share be in the high wage countries. Now, the total gross number of posted workers in 2014 was a bit less than 2 million. But, you know, this is a very, very gross number. You know, here I gave a simple example. Suppose that there is one job, let's say, in Belgium, and in each month, a different posted worker fills this job. So it would mean, you know, 12 people are involved in the posting. But, you know, in the whole year, it was only one job. So this gross number clearly exaggerates on how many jobs are possibly taken from the local economy by posted workers. And luckily for some countries, the European Commission published data on this so-called full-time equivalent. So again, if the full-time equivalent means that, you know, let's say if you have five workers by a company and it calculates, you know, how many full-time positions would be the equivalent. So it takes into account the duration of posting, also whether the posting is full-time or part-time or and things like that. And unfortunately, this data is available only for certain sending countries, and in particular, it's not available for Poland, the biggest sending country, but it's available for Germany and a couple of other big countries. And in these 13 countries, the total gross is about 750,000, but the full-time equivalent is one-third of that, 250,000. And if you look at what is the share of these 250,000 people in the share of total employment, then you see it's 0.26%. Now, then please recall that in the previous slide here, you know, I showed you that the real concern is from this low wage to high wage, which was about one third. So if you know, indeed one third is from low wage to high wage, and is only about 0.3% of the full-time equivalent of posted workers, then if you multiply this 0.3 by one-third, then you get 0.1% of total employment. So overall, this posted worker problem, in my view, is at the aggregate level is very, very small. Now, certainly for this 1.9 million people, and in particular for the people coming from low-wage to high-wage countries, this is a really crucial problem. So there are several hundred thousand people for which posting can be a problem. But overall, it's a very, very small problem. So again, I mean, this suggests me that maybe this should not be the major scope of new and increased regulation. So I just argued that you know, posting of workers is not really important. It's much more important for the import of cheap labor, importing goods, and offshoring to production. So if really would take literally this same pay at the same place regulation, then what would be the logical next step? I mean, the logical next step would be that we should set, you know, intra-EU trade barriers. So let's say if you know, Germany imports something from Latvia, there should be a tariff compensating the wage differences. And there should be also, you know, barriers to offshoring. So if a German company wants to establish a factory in Poland, it should be penalized. So I think that this simply the same pay at the same place principle, simply it's impossible to implement. But also if you want to implement it, then there should be much, much important issues, much, you know, significant issues like the imports of goods and offshoring, which have much more decisive impact on labor conditions in host countries. So why there are so much discussion on posted workers? You know, one point, as I already mentioned in my introduction, that they are visible. So if, again, an IT there was an IT man here in the room, not from Latvia, but from another country, then you would be able to observe by if you go to the supermarket and buy a Chinese product, then you don't directly observe. And since there's a major negative attitude toward immigration in general in many, many countries, especially in the most vocal countries like like France and Belgium, which countries are most vocal against the posted workers. Certainly all aspects of immigration is at least in the public perception, is a great concern, and certainly posted worker is one. Also, in some of these countries, unemployment is still high. I mean, unemployment in Germany is very low, but in France and also Belgium, it is relatively high, especially youth unemployment is still very high in these countries. And so when there is high unemployment and people perceive that, you know, cheap labor is coming from Poland or from whatever, then certainly perception is negative. But also there were abuses, major abuses of the Posted Workers Directive, and that was also a problem. But before discussing the abuses, just briefly, you know, what are the main regulations of this Posted Workers Directive? So it says that it's not so easy to explain in very simple terms, but in general, I think it, hope this slide summarizes. So basically, the posted workers are subject to host country laws or regulations or administrative provisions concerning a number of areas. One is the minimum wage. The other one is what is the maximum work period, including what is the minimum rest period. What is the minimum paid annual holiday? So again, all local regulations, if a Latvian worker goes to France or Belgium, he has to comply. Conditions of hiring out workers, health, safety, hygiene at work, you know, the non-discrimination and protection of, let's say, pregnant women, equal treatment between men and women, and so on. So clearly, I think there were quite many, you know, regulations which postal workers have to comply with. And again, the sectoral issue is a bit complicated. It's obligatory everywhere. Everything is obligatory in construction, but by optional in other sectors. But overall, I think that even the current regulations provide relatively broad standards for protecting the social standards of posted workers. But there are many abuses. And there are clearly key issues which should be fought back. One typical example is a so-called letterbox company. And for example, a German company sees that, you know, wage costs are very high in Germany, so it establishes, let's say, a company here in Riga, sends here, you know, a secretary who is here, you know, once a week, and pretends that, you know, the workers are sent from Latvia to Germany, and therefore it can, you know, benefit from Latvian positions. I mean, clearly this is unacceptable, and should be really tackled. Another is a bogus self-employment, whereby people, posted workers, are not actually employed, but they are forced to make, you know, so not employed by the company who is actually gives them work, but forced to be self-employed and, you know, issue an invoice to the company, and thereby also a couple of you know, labor standards can be avoided. Also, many times, you know, there was exploitation of posted workers, because many of these, especially the low-trained people, don't really know their rights, and companies simply abused and didn't comply. And there was also a major issue of subcontracting, that, you know, a company employs a subcontractor, that employs another subcontractor, and then another subcontractor, and so on. And in these long subcontracting chains, at the end, the worker is lost, and nobody is protected his or her rights, or even didn't receive any pay at the end. So there were major abuses, which really, I mean, an issue. And again, even as I said that posted worker over is a small problem, it's a big problem for those couple of 100,000 people who are involved in it and who are abused. Now, social dumping. As I said, I really find this term inappropriate, So I first looked at, you know, what social dumping means in international, what dumping means in international trade. In an international trade, if you look at any simple textbook, just let me read that, a producer of a foreign country, let's say a producer in Latvia, prices export to Germany, either below the price it's charged in home market, so the price in Germany is smaller than in Latvia, or even below its production cost. But the problem is that, not the problem, but the issue is that there is no such dumping happens if the posted worker directive is abided by, because as I already argued, you know, the labor standards and the minimum wages has to be paid to posted workers, and you know, since minimum wages in Germany are higher than in Latvia, then certainly the company, you know, cannot really, you know, price wages below below the Latvian wages, and cannot really price, you know, a cheaper price. An alternative definition, which comes from you, I have to say, is that the practice of undermining or evading existing social regulations with the aim of gaining competitive advantage. But again, I mean, I find it difficult to see that when the Posted Worker Directive is abided by, so all regulations are complied with, are difficult to see because, you know, as I listed here, you know, there are regulations on work periods, rest periods, holiday, you know, health, safety, protecting pregnant women, equal treatment, and so on. So when the Posted Worker Directive is abided by, then I don't really see the scope for social dumping, I have to say, but I look forward to hearing what you will say, Magdalena. Now, my time is running out, so I have to work up, speed up a little bit. So the Commission in March, as I mentioned, made some proposal, and I think when the Commission was working on it between 14 and March this year, they simply realized that this equal pay principle is simply impossible to implement. I mean, there are, you know, pay differences even within a company, depending on how productive the workers are. You know, if someone is more productive during the same time, generates, you know, more goods or better ideas and so on, then certainly he or she should receive a higher pay. Also, even within the same industry, there are two companies, there are also pay differences between two companies, again, depending on conditions. There are also many, you know, different way how the wages are set. In some countries, there are nationwide wage setting procedure, at least for the wage increases, certainly not the levels for the wage increasing. In other countries, it's decentralized. Again, in other countries, it's completely left to the company. So there are so many different, you know, labor market institutions that I think the Commission realized that this equal pay principle is simply impossible to implement. But they had to do something because they promised to do. So what they came out is that they changed the reference to minimum rates of pay, so from minimum wages to remuneration. And what they say, propose, is that all kind of regulations in the host country should apply to posted workers, which means that, for example, in a country there's a general agreement on, let's say, the 13th month salary which workers receive at the end of the year, then it also should be applied to the country. So this regulation, if it will go through, it will increase somewhat the cost of posted workers, but clearly will not be able to achieve the same pay at the same rate, same pay for the same work at the same pay principle. And that's why, you know, it received criticisms for the supporters of this principle, saying that it's not ambitious enough, but also received criticisms from the other side, saying that, you know, it will make posting more expensive, somewhat more expensive, and thereby it will limit the freedom of movement of services. And there were also a couple of other issues here, like on subcontracting, on posted temporary agency. Also, they now define what is long-term posting and say that after 2 years, posted workers basically convert under the national labor laws. So I don't say that, you know, these proposals are misplaced. I think they have some merits. But what I do say is that First of all, it was, I think, not the right time to do that, because the enforcement directive has not yet been implemented everywhere. I mean, it should have been implemented by summer this year, but the Commission came out with this proposal in March. But even more importantly, the Commission is expected to prepare a report on how the enforcement directive is implemented. And I think the right time to discuss whether the underlying principles of the Processing Workers Directive should be changed should have come after the assessment on how well the directive is implemented. So I think even doing, making this proposal even before the implementation deadline has passed, I think that was not a good timing at all. And now I think I have only two more slides. So the elephant in the room is undeclared work. You know, it's difficult to measure, but if you look at the share of the shadow economy in the high-wage countries, so I don't speak about Greece and Italy, where it's much higher, but high-wage countries, then according to the latest estimates I saw, it ranges between 9% in Luxembourg to 21% in Belgium. Now, undeclared work is typically more labor-extensive, for example, in a construction or cleaning ladies and so on. So probably the share in employment of undeclared work is much higher than the share in output. But in any case, even if you just look at this 9%, and you know, you recall my estimate that, you know, posted workers in high-wage countries account for 0.1% of the labor force, then just in Luxembourg, there is a 100-time difference between the total number of undeclared people and posted workers. In Belgium, it's more than 200 times. So there are 200 times more undeclared workers in Belgium than posted workers. And you know, undeclared workers, that's the social dumping, by the way. So I think undeclared work is a social dumping, because if someone's undeclared, there's no social protection at all, you know, no health care coverage, no pensions. They can receive whatever wage the company is paying. If the company doesn't pay, the worker cannot complain and cannot sue the company. So I think undeclared work is the social dumping. And you know, if we move for a more you know, equal pay principle, that could even increase undeclared work. So now that this is just my brief summary. So I mean, first statement is that economic integration brings benefits. This is clearly the founding principle of the EU. As also Mabzilla mentioned, the four freedom of providing goods, services, labor, and capital in the EU is the founding principle, and the reason is I think, well justified that it brings benefits. But there are always losers. So if you know, more production is offshore to, let's say, Poland and Romania, then there are losers in Germany and France. Again, the same happens with globalization. If we import more and more from China and Vietnam, again, there are losers in Europe. But the issue is not, you know, to be more protectionist and to block free trade of goods or services, but to, you know, find ways to help those people who are the losers, find ways to retrain themselves, to find new jobs, better jobs, and so on. And there will be always competition between low-wage and high-wage countries. I mean, it cannot be circumvented. Even if a strict revision of the Posted Worker Directive would limit severely the postings, still, as I said, importing and offshoring will be major channels through wage competition. As I argued, that posting is a very small issue compared to imports of goods and offshoring. Certain aspects of the Posted Workers Directive should be addressed, I agree, but I think this is not the main priority, and this is not the right time to do that. It would have been much better, let's say, in 2-3 years from now, when we will have the report by the Commission on how the enforcement directive has been implemented. As I argued, undeclared work is more than 100 times more important, in some countries even more. So I think that's what we should focus on. And thank you for your attention.
Well, so thank you, Mr. Darbas. That's really a brilliant presentation. On the next panel, I think I have to shorten my presentation, because you did it with the same argumentation, but much more academic and professionally, with the same arguments which I use, maybe sometimes more political ones. But thank you very much. And I think it's very interesting what you said about this doubts about, is it possible to do equality in the same place, in a single market which is much broader than the same place? So if we were speaking about the same place, we can go to very crazy issues like
Wallonie in Belgium, separated from other part like from Flanders or Brussels, or we can go to German lenders and to create an absolutely crazy situation. At the same time, I think it's also a very good point about undeclared work and posting workers issue. This, I think, and subcontracting. What we have here in Latvia, for example, in construction work, subcontracting, we are doing very well with the consequences, which is mainly negative. So but thank you, Mr. Darvas. Now I would like to, we can also change to use this time, I would like to introduce you with Magdalena Bernicek. Magdalena is a senior researcher in a European Trade Union Institute, which is also based in Belgium. And if I'm correct, yeah? but Magdalena is also Hungarian. He holds MA degrees.
She's Polish.
Oh, he's from?
Yes.
Oh, sorry. Sorry about you. So Magdalena is Polish, but she studied in a political science at Central European University Budapest. That's why I'm confused from, so, but sorry about once more time about this. And also Magdalena has experience in working with in other states, European member states as well, like economic and social research in Düsseldorf and in University of Warwick. Where actually Edgars Zivets, who very much organized this conference, he also did the same university. So Magdalena, floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Mr. Zille, and thank you very much once again for the invitation and for the very interesting presentation that preceded mine. During my talk, referring to the topic of the conference and also referring partly to the previous presentation, I will, on one hand, try to outline the concept of social dumping and show how it possibly could still be applied to the analysis of European integration. And in the second part of the presentation, I will, as a political economist by profession, I would put the current debate on the revision of posting into a broader discussion on balance between social protections and economic liberalization in Europe. So the term social dumping has made quite a career in recent years. It has been used by policymakers, more and more by scholars, and also in popular discourse. And as noticed by Mr. Zille, it influenced certain policy decisions. It proved powerful enough to influence policy choices, such as the failure of French and Dutch constitutional treaty referenda, perhaps also partially the Brexit debate that preceded this. Much as it was popular, it remained relatively vague and underdefined. So on one hand, it focused on low-wage country actors and put lower wages and inferior working conditions as a synonym of social dumping. Standards in countries which allegedly were involved in this type of practices were presented as lower than they would have been, which suggests that there should be some sort of universal level of working conditions that we know does not exist, or universal standard in this area. And it uses the counterfactuals, which by definition cannot really be in any way verified. Discussions and also academic takes on this issue were very often concentrating on specific phenomena, specific threats, without really looking at this in a broader sense. So this vagueness combined with high political resonance of the term made us look to the issue a bit more in detail. And in 2013, we launched a project at ETUI when we tried to look what comes behind this type of discourse and, if possible, to provide a positive as opposed to negative, as opposed to normative definitions of this term, so that really look at the mechanism, possible mechanism behind social dumping practices. So the point of departure of the research that we did, the conceptualization part, and then research that we gathered on different social dumping practices, was the assertion that regulation, so markets are not really governed by invisible hands. They are based on regulations, and well-functioning markets are actually based on regulations that made market participants get involved in their exchanges in a clear, transparent, and predictable manner. Social regulations, from this perspective, also constitute a part of this market construction. They embed markets in a system of regulatory checks and controls, which might, in the short term, prove, in a way, slightly limiting for the actors, but in the long run, might actually even prove beneficial for the participants of market exchanges by providing them with, as I said, predictable market environment, make them invest in long-term relationships and raise productivity through developing trust relations within companies. Now, these protective arrangements collide or might collide with strategic choices of market participants, much as regulations in the long term are beneficial, as I mentioned. Market participants forced to operate in line with the short-term market logic might view social norms and regulations as obstacles to profit maximization, especially in the short term. On the other hand, even though at the aggregate level, this type of constraints might again have beneficial effect, from the perspective on the individual market participant, it would be best if he or she could evade the existing constraints while his or her opponents or other competitors would be still abiding them. So there is a certain incentive within the very capitalism system to try to avoid the existing constraints, including the ones in social sphere. And this is how we conceptualize social dumping, the definition that was also brought by Mr. Darvas. We viewed it as a practice which is undertaken by self-interested market participants of undermining or evading the existing social regulations with an aim of gaining a short-term competitive advantage. Now, this definition focuses very much on the mechanisms of social dumping, and in this sense, this is a pretty much universal phenomenon in the sense of being present in the very logic of competition on capitalist markets. And this is how actually we looked at this, and case studies that followed in the book that we eventually published on that showed a range of this type of rule binding or rule bending or rule avoiding practices, not only limited to migration or posting, as it is now suggested in the debates, not only involving actors from low-wage countries. We had cases of subcontracting chains when the main contractor imposed certain conditions on its subcontractors coming from perhaps lower-wage countries. So the whole idea or like the impulse for rule bending came actually not from low-wage countries at all, or not from actors, from this this type of more permissive settings, but actually from the high-wage country actors. And after all, it actually doesn't really have to be a cross-border phenomenon. So we had case studies of, in the manufacturing industry of companies that replace their permanent workforce with the temporary ones, or use the temporary one as a sort of leverage in order to exert pressure of on working conditions of the permanent workforce. So even the cross-border phenomenon does not really have to, or cross-border dimension does not really have to be involved in it. Now, in the studies that we had, we looked at various practices that pointed to two different forms of social dumping or two different types of behavior of this kind that I mentioned. On one hand, it really has to do with the outright violation of social regulations, so being illegal as such. But then we also identified a number of practices which were not illegal per se, but were based on this kind of way regime shopping, strategizing between different regulatory systems and manipulating social rules so that to avoid social obligations specific for certain regulatory areas. And from this broader perspective, posting in line with host country minima does create what Nathan Lilly in his research called spaces of regulatory exclusion from host country regulations. This is the fact. And from this broader perspective on rules and regulations, and not only illegal but also strategizing aspect of social dumping, this type of behavior, creating or systematic use of differences in regulatory setting, regulatory exclusion of posted workers from the rules of host countries, used to generate cost advantages, could be considered social dumping. Now, whether to change the regulations or not, this is already another issue. And the question is, how much posting really matters? Mr. Darvas gave you a very good assessment of this. I will not repeat what he says, but I will add a bit of comments from the perspective of a political economist, which I am. So, of course, as a political economist, I would say it matters, and it, well, yes and no, or rather no or yes. So it is indeed a very small phenomenon. Newest research shows even lower full-time equivalent share of posting employment, so 0.2. And indeed, at the aggregate level, there is no evidence for job displacements. This data that I am basing here, my argument on, they are coming really from the crisis period, 2008, 2009. But indeed, they show that aggregate level host countries do not really face job displacement because of the inflow of posted workers. But at the same time, indeed, this is an activity which tends to be concentrated in specific sectors. Construction accounts for 42% of all posting. In some countries, such as Belgium, this goes well beyond 50%. And indeed, scattered but available evidence from mostly qualitative studies shows that in certain, I agree, very specific market segments, we feature some of negative consequences. And indeed, there is a wage gap that is being created. We have surveys of in Denmark. We had evidence from Germany, where really the most basic minimum rates of pay applied to posted workers without, of course they can be paid more, but in principle this is what you are being paid, or this is what you are entitled. You might be paid more, of course, but this might indeed lead to certain pressures on host country wage levels, and this were documented again, for instance, in southern Finland, where living standards and wages, living costs and wages are relatively high. And this is also the region where most posting in the country is concentrated, because you can post workers on minimum rates, which of course creates a certain or gives you a certain competitive advantage over the local service providers, given that they pay more. So this type of effects are indeed in very specific, as I say, but still some market segments are being signaled. There is also some evidence for job displacement in Belgian construction. There is an evidence of loss of tenders by companies in Germany who cannot compete when this subcontracting chain, arguably created by local companies, still provide a certain advantage to those who are able to pay less by contracting posting companies. What also creates a potential problem is the fact that according to slightly earlier commission studies, low-wage countries tend to post mainly low- and medium-skilled workers in labor-intensive sectors. We might think that these are the sectors in which wage factor will again play quite an important role, which might lead to tensions in these market segments that are affected. So all in all, losses are relatively concentrated and benefits are diffused. When we add to this publicized instances of abuse that was there, we have fears and negative perceptions dominating the posting debate, which is again not new. So there was a survey in 2004 conducted in Germany after quite a few very high profile cases of relocation of automotive and telecommunications production to Eastern Europe, 73% of Germans were afraid of losing their jobs due to relocation. So it really influences public perceptions, even if losses are relatively concentrated. As for trade union position, it's relatively consistent, I would say, over time, because they were actually lobbying for higher levels of protections already during the initial posting negotiations. And this position was based on two types of arguments, or two legs, two tracks. One would be related to the function of collective agreements not in Poland and not in Latvia, because this we don't have so much. But actually, if we think the function is basically to take wage to a certain extent out of competition by setting certain standards of remuneration in this particular regulatory environment. And as I said, by importing labor that could be subject to different rules, this might create certain tensions and pressures on these established collective bargaining frames. And so in order to avoid this, the equal wage principle was put on the table. And it is a principle in a way. So it was used earlier in relation to women, in relation to temporary workers, with a big debate in Germany some 10 years ago on trying to equalize the wages of temporary workers with that of the permanent workforce. And now it is being extended in a way to cross-border contexts in relation to posting, and at the same time linked to the non-discrimination rule, non-discrimination on the basis of nationality and or the country of origin. It is also interesting that from the very outset of EU integration process, this sort of cost competitiveness, anti-low wage rhetorics was supported very much and by Central Eastern European unions. We can talk about the reasons and for this a bit later, because I just wrote a paper on the Polish position of unions on many social dumping prone debates in the region. But basically, the logic is very similar to the second point here on the slide. So in order to safeguard certain frames to which we aspire, we don't really want to have them ruined, because there is nothing that we can aspire to in the future. So this was the logic very much used. But the very debate is not new, and just to perhaps broaden our picture, because we really think about the revision, this is on the table, but this is not a new debate. It has been there, and it was very much since the beginning of talks on the Posted Workers Directive or on regulating this area, already in the late 80s and beginning of 90s, there was a cleavage, significant cleavage in very crude terms, between, on one hand, receiving countries, high-wage European countries, northwest, that opted for higher levels of protection for posted workers, and those from the sending countries who either were against the regulation of the issue at the European level or opted for lower levels of protection for this category of employees. This debate was ended only when the European Court of Justice allowed countries to introduce the minima and then sealed this option at the European level in the form of directive. But there was no agreement virtually after 10 years of debates on the issue. And when we see at today's picture, perhaps country as such could move a bit. So those who were against in the 80s, 90s might now be for the revision. But what we can see is that still the cleavage between sending and receiving countries is very much present in the current debate as well. So the factor prices and factor productivity is indeed reflected in the positions. So here you have the net numbers of posting. And with red, you have the signatories of the letter against the revision sent in 2015 to the Commissioner Thyssen, whereas on the green side, on the right side, you have the countries that sent a counter letter, or was it the other way around? Who sent the letter first?
They started.
Yeah, they started, and then we. So, but yeah, you can see that the cleavage is clearly there and has been. So sometimes this cleavage is put in, given quite strong names, like Clash of Capitalisms by Callaghan and Hübner a couple of years ago. But the essential idea is really as, well, conflict is perhaps too much said, or a clash, but indeed the coexistence of two very different visions of European integration, socio-economic order in Europe, the one based more on economic freedoms and those espousing more social protection. And this cleavage indeed became a bit more visible after the EU Eastern enlargement, with Eastern European countries being generally more pro-market than the Western ones. But it was pleasant already earlier with UK and Ireland and the debates that preceded the accession of Eastern European countries. But just to illustrate the cleavage and the differences between countries, on the first picture you see the written country observations that were submitted on the Viking case, or Viking, submitted to ECJ by individual member states, and the case was basically about the balance or between free movement of services and the right of unions to enforce certain working conditions and wages through industrial action in national context. So the whole East, almost the whole East, plus the UK, was very much on the side of the free movement of services. Commission, Ireland, Advocate General, and the final decision pretty much in the middle, but still tending really for the more liberal version. And the Western countries, the whole Scandinavia, but also continental Western European countries, supporting unions' right, extended right to collective action in case of defense of social standards. So this was present there very much before. Similar cleavages emerge in voting patterns at the European Parliament, a very much national cleavage, so these were the governmental positions that you see on the crowd, but within the MEPs, a national cleavage was very much visible in the case of EU Takeover Directive. This is voting still before EU accession, really. And there, countries that could be harmed by the introduction of hostile takeovers, especially coordinated market economies such as Germany, MEPs from these countries, irrespective of their grouping, from the irrespective of their membership in political groupings in the parliament, voted, and the representative of other coordinated market economies voted against this extended draft, actually, version of the directive. Now, the national cleavage was not that much, it was still present, but not to that extent in the voting on EU Services Directive. But there, the decision was more taken on the basis of individual preferences of MEPs. So it was indeed, to a certain extent, sending versus receiving countries, but then also individual preferences of MEPs were reflected in the voting patterns. In any case, what seems to be now with the revision proposal and another or other initiatives in the social sphere, there seem to be a window of opportunity at EU level to address and consolidate social acquis. So we had the initial statements of Commissioner Juncker, we have the revision project, and in general the EU social pillar agenda, still arguably not very defined, but aiming at consolidating and strengthening the social acquis. So this is on the table, or the climate is favorable for this type of proposals. But what we can see from this short presentation of very different stances is that the setting the limits of permissible company behavior, setting the regulations in the first place, is very much a political process. It is defined, and the outcome of it is pretty much defined by the balance of power between different groups pertaining to these two quite different policy visions. And When I was preparing for this presentation, I remembered one of the chapters in the book that we had on social dumping, and that was a chapter by two authors from Scandinavian countries, from Denmark and Norway, in many ways similar countries. In both, there was a debate, so what standards are to be applied to migrant workers? Should it be equal status or the minima that would be set by generally applicable collective agreements? And Denmark went for equal treatment, whereas Norway, for the first time, introduced in sectors which were arguably in threat of wages and working conditions being undercut, they introduced for the first time generally applicable collective agreements that set this minima. And these two very divergent outcomes had a lot to do with the government colors at this time and with the power of interest groups at the national level, with unions being much stronger in the Danish setting than in the Norwegian. And if I just cannot... Another example from the original posting debate, Germany at the time was actually opting for a more diluted version of the directive. FDP, the liberals, were in the coalition back then, and BDA, the employer organization, was quite strong. So this configuration at the national level shaped very much the country's position. So it is all fluid, but it will take time, I guess, to consolidate or to console and find a compromise in this whole debate. So, but just to conclude very quickly, social dumping is, I think the concept is still useful because it defines certain behaviors which are universally applicable across different countries and that are based on evading or infringement of applicable social regulations. And its conceptualization goes also beyond this legal-illegal dichotomy, which arguably doesn't make it easier to regulate this behavior, and I agree very much that this is not so easy. On the other hand, as I said, the struggle behind the posting revision is very much a political, economic battle of ideas or battle of interests, shaped both by interest groups at national and transnational level. In any case, I would like to signal still, and irrespective of the final results, I'm just finishing already, I would like to mention three issues that we should still think about. So on one hand, again, we are all set on revision of the posting directive, but rather than putting all eggs to one basket, I would still suggest to pay more attention to the enforcement problems that are out there and all the issues that Mr. Darvas very rightly pointed to. So we had still many problems that are still not solved related to undeclared work, related to all the pathologies that Mr. Darvas mentioned. And it's quite surprising that still half of the countries are not really enforcing the directive, or it is a bit of a wait and see approach given the negotiations on the revision. But in fact, these are very different issues when it comes to the issues, regulatory issues that are to be covered by the two acts. So I think we need in parallel to lead negotiations perhaps on the revision, but at the same time look at the proper enforcement and elimination of the most blatant abuses which are out there. Second, the application of the original posted directive seems problematic in many countries. I had a talk with a Polish lawyer from a trade union organization, and then with my new Latvian colleague in the organization that I am from, the ETUI, that also signaled that in the Latvian context there is many ambiguities with the application of, you know, you have to pay posted workers the minimum wages, but then what to do with the allowances that you have to pay for them for going abroad, how to reconcile these issues. So we are actually launching also a project now at the Institute to look at this type of application problems in the national context. But they are still there and they should also be signaled and settled if possible. And finally, just a very short reflection, because when I was reading the impact assessment of the Commission, it somehow presupposes in a way that by raising the wages, companies will move on higher levels of value-added chain or value-added ladder, which is, however, not an automatic process and much as it is desired. So I was thinking in what sense perhaps this type of move and search for different than only cost-related sources of competitiveness could be supported by the state acting as a developmental state by concentrated and perhaps targeted policies related to improving skill levels and other sorts of policies at national level that would help companies move beyond costs and cost-based competitiveness and invest in other things such as higher quality, better productivity. And I think it is slowly a time for this type of debate in Eastern Europe. We had a project last year on FDI that showed that actually FDI went down in the last years during the crisis. So we might really need another source of growth, and we have to think really how to, if at possible, how we could shape or co-shape the development of competences that could allow our service exporters also to be competitive and well-positioned in the EU single market. So yeah, I think this is a pertinent debate both in my country, Poland, but also here in Latvia, and we could perhaps still all together think about it. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much, Magdalena, for your very interesting presentation. It was very interesting also with argumentation from the trade union point of view where you are working. That's why I'm really hear some very serious arguments in favor of what you are proposing. At the same time, I cannot hear it in Brussels very often, in Parliament side, I would say so, among my colleagues. But you remind that very interesting point on service directive, which was actually, there was a country of origin principle, which was a key point for developing of a single market in a service sector. Actually, the vote was very easy. There was no left and right. There was west and east decision by the parliamentarians. And those who are supporting employers and employees on western side, they outvoted those who are from the Central and Eastern Europe, from both sides, left and right. So that was it's pretty interesting point. And very interesting, and I think we will debate later on, point I think was in your presentation was, let's remove labor costs out of competition. I feel also some ideas to let's remove taxation policy out of competition in European single market. Let's remove perhaps energy costs from out of competition. So I just worried about how European Union services will be and businesses would be able to compete on a global market if we will exclude everything out of competition in a single market. So, but let's leave it for debate. Now I would like to introduce with Marek Benio, also this time it's Vice President of Management Board of Labor Market Initiative in Poland, I suppose Polish our member. And Marek Benio is actually he's a lawyer, but at the same time he has a PhD in economics. And I think it's very important and good combination when you can make a professional attitude in law and also in economics at the same time. He's the author of numerous publications on social security, labor law, public economy and administration, and supervisor of over 200 MAE and diplomas as well. And he's one of the 10 best lecturers in the Krakow University of Economics. Mr. Benio, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I'm really pleased to be here. Thank you for inviting me. And since the previous two presentations took 75% of my presentation, as far as the merits are concerned, I will only focus on my own research, which actually shows that even if you can imagine a very vicious employer who came down or who came up from hell to this earth, in only one purpose, to do social dumping, the least tool he or she should choose is posting of workers. And I intend to prove it within 10 minutes. But before I get there, this is just a reminder of what we've heard at this morning session, that there are two types of social dumping. One is based on import of migrant workers, and another one, which is much larger, as you said, is based on export of operations. So the traditional definition of social dumping is when a company moves its operation to a country where labor is cheaper. And that is happening also within the European Union, when a German company is establishing a car company, a car production company, or actually car mantling company, because they produce the parts in Germany, they move it to Poland, and they assemble them in Poland. And the German labor market does not feel the pain of 3,000 lost jobs who are gained by the Polish workers. Now, of course, social dumping is not dealt with from that perspective on the European level. So please bear in mind that when we speak about social dumping from now on, we are talking only about this import of migrant workers, and especially through posting of workers. We do have some indicators now in European law, because we've witnessed this September in Strasbourg, at the last session of the Parliament, the acceptance of the resolution on social dumping, and that was the initiative of member of European Parliament, Monsieur Guillaume Ballas, and he has specified in his proposal, and the Parliament accepted it, that social dumping consists only of illegal practices, only of abuses of law. So as long as you play legally, you may not be accused for doing social dumping. So we could say that getting competitive advantage on the basis of the lower labor costs actually strengthens the external EU competitiveness. Because it means that by producing cheaper or by delivering cheaper goods, we can compete in a global economy as European market, as single market. So if you for a moment try to stop thinking of yourselves as Latvians, Polish, Hungarians, or Polish, and pretend that we are all Europeans. We are not, but let's pretend for a while. Then gaining external competitive advantage could be by using the lowest possible costs that we have in the internal market. As long as you do this without abusing labor, without abusing people, and within legal frameworks that we've established. On the contrary, lowering the labor costs illegally, so by undeclared work, for instance, which is the biggest internal problem of the internal market, that would be social dumping, and that's based on either bogus self-employment or undeclared work, which leads to forced labor, human trafficking, and this is happening right now, right here in Europe. It's not an like Asian phenomenon. It's really happening now in Europe. So if you look at the definition proposed, which actually starts with the sentence that there is no definition, but the concept of social dumping, according to Guillaume Ballas' report, covers wide range of intentionally abusive practices and the circumvention of the existing European and national legislation, which enable the development of unfair competition by unlawfully minimizing labor and operation costs and lead to violations of workers' rights and exploitation of workers. That is, let's say, the European definition of social dumping accepted by the Parliament last September. Now, I've highlighted a few words, and I put a question on top of that definition. Is posting of workers social dumping? Is posting of workers an abusive practice? Is it a circumvention of rules? Is it unlawful minimizing of labor costs? And the answers to all those questions is not. So if not, then let's please stop talking about posting of workers as the source of social dumping, because it is a legal practice. It is lawful. It is according to rules. Only when you break the law, you will be treated as social dumper. I actually would propose another look or perspective on posting of workers. Posting of workers can actually be the best cohesion tool for the European Union. How come? Well, we have this very nice example of Bulgarian worker who's very happy to work for Danish minimum wage. Well, when Bulgarian worker goes to Denmark and forced by the directive on posting of workers earns minimum Danish wage, he earns 3 to 7 times more than back home for doing exactly the same job. And of course we have the equality problem, because back there in Sofia, there is a specialist who's doing the same job, possibly for the same company, for lower money. Now, where is the equality between those two workers? Should the Bulgarian employer pay the Bulgarian worker working in Bulgaria the Danish minimum wage only because he is posting another person to Denmark? Nobody has ever raised this question, and please do not tell the members of European Parliament, especially in S&D group. But actually, if you answer this equality problem in a positive way, then you end up with equal pay all over Europe. And I'm the very best advocate of equal pay. I'd like to see Polish and Latvian workers earning the same money as German worker or Danish worker, but not only when they work in Germany or Denmark, but also when they do the same job back home. Now, this is a beautiful dream of equality, but the last tool to implement it is to decree it in law. If you write something in law, it doesn't mean that it will happen. Actually, the economists hopefully will agree that this will end up in a larger gray zone or black market or undeclared work. So you have to be very delicate with the regulation. Okay, this is a coincidence, really. We didn't know each other before we've met, but here is the same citation from Mr. Darvas. It's actually a citation of Jean-Claude Juncker, who said that in our union, the same work at the same place should be remunerated in the same manner. Do you see equal pay principle in this declaration? There is none. He's only saying, and if you read the proposal of the Commission carefully, you will discover the same. They both say that the remuneration should be calculated according to the same algorithm, but it doesn't mean they have to be equal. So if you have a Dutch worker and a Latvian worker working, a posted Latvian worker to the Netherlands doing the same job, the Dutch worker can still earn 5,000 euro and the Latvian will be earning 3,000 euro. The difference after this targeted revision will be that both their remuneration must consist of the same elements. So if there is a place to lower down the basic wage of the Latvian worker and adding some supplements, that are characteristic for the Dutch law, then it may as well end up with exactly the same level of remuneration as before the change. And that certainly does not lead to equalizing. But if you have a Latvian worker who is actually earning only minimum wage in the Netherlands, then that targeted revision leads to increase of his wage, which is obviously a beautiful thing, as long as he keeps the job. Because if this increase causes the raise of the cost of service, perhaps the client in the Netherlands will not take the service from the Latvian service company. Perhaps they will look for a, not a Dutch company. A non-nationalist, without nationality, economic bandit, I wouldn't call him company, who will offer this service for even a lower price by hiring Latvians, Polish, Bulgarians for €2 an hour. And that is the real problem of internal labor market, which has been said already. Thank you very much. Undeclared work. Those words, along with the words of Commissioner Tyson, were very inspiring for me because that led me to do a research. And I wanted to see how these ideas behind the targeted revision are going to be implemented. Commissioner Tyson says we need more posting, not less. I couldn't agree more. How is the Commission going to implement this more posting, not less? Well, generally by hiring the cost of the service, which is cross-border, and by limiting it in time. Now, that is not the tool to achieve that result. So I see the clash here. So I thought, let's look, and we need fairer rules and a level playing field. So let's see how the field is unleveled now, because there is assumption that the playing field is not leveled. So who's got harder time? Who's got uphill and who's got downhill? The local service companies or the cross-border service companies? So we've done a survey, and it's not very impressive. You're going to laugh, because I got only 16 questionnaires back. So please call it a pilot, okay? But under these 16 questionnaires that we've sent to real companies posting real posted workers, we've covered more than 20,000 portable documents A1. This does not mean that there were 20,000 workers, no. If you try to use the full-time equivalent, you will probably end up with some 5,000 workers. Five-time, full-time equivalent. But we were interested in the structure of cost of labor, so we've assumed a more conservative approach, and we've assumed that the number of workers is 75% of the number of those A1 documents issued by Social Security. We are speaking only about legal posting. Those are all posted workers who were notified by when they were sent to another country. And this survey covered 3 years, 2013, 14, and 15. I want to stress that because most posting is going to be from Poland to Germany in this study, in Germany, the minimum wage, universally applicable minimum wage, was introduced in January 2015. So it is possible that in the first 2 years, some workers were earning actually lower wage than minimum German wage. The biggest advantage of this survey is not its large number of questionnaires, but the biggest advantage is that we looked inside the books of the companies. And this survey is based on the real labor costs, on the real data from the companies. So it is not like a sublime assessment of law and trying to see how high would be the remuneration if we applied rules. No. This actually is a real picture of the structure of the cost. That's the biggest advantage of this survey. If you look at the survey by the number of posted workers by country or share by country, then you will see, oops, it actually touches. Then you see that 47% were posted to Germany, 34% to France, and 19% to Belgium. And that more or less resembles the real market. So it is a bit representative from that perspective. There were also two countries, Sweden and Norway, but I only had 4 workers posted in the survey, so they are not visible on the screen. If you look by sector, most of them are posted in the construction sector. The second largest group is in care for elderly, and that's especially to Germany. There is also production sector, logistics, and metal industry. Of course, services in metal industry. The first finding was very interesting, that the lowest ever gained remuneration in this survey, in this 20,000 cases, was €5.98 an hour, and that's net remuneration. So that's as low as you can get. This is perhaps lower than minimum wage, let's say, in Germany. But if you look at the average earnings, and that's interesting finding, the average earnings was €10, well, €9.95 under this survey, which, and that's net, which shows that Polish posted workers from those 16 companies, they on average earn more than minimum wages required in the host countries. Well, I could finish here because this slide shows that there is no social dumping because people are already paid more than minimum wage. So, but we looked at the structure. And the structure consists of net wage, tax and contributions, and those are the dues that you have to pay no matter if you pay the remuneration inside your country or cross-border. Those are the costs that you have to bear. And then we have cross-border costs, which are, some of them are fixed, and those we've divided by the number of posted workers, which we assumed was 75% of the number of A1s, documents, and cross-border variable costs. Those cross-border costs are the costs that the employer has to pay only when they cross the border. So if the service was provided locally, those costs would not occur. So that would be competitive disadvantage of being a posting company. Tax and contributions, well, here are the examples of those mandatory dues, but I'll skip those because I want to focus on the cross-border costs. Which are they? Well, the cost of accommodation, the cost of travel, board, the cost of compensation for fixed-term contract, it's a French invention, and it's applied both to French workers and to posted workers, posted to France. Those are the types of costs that you would not have to bear if you did not post worker from Poland. So it's not applicable in Poland. But it is applicable in France, so there is equal treatment from that perspective. Holiday compensation, but there are also some costs that are not occurred, never occurred, by local company, and those are the cost of translation, the cost of notification, translation of the documentation of worker, the cost of notification, the cost of currency exchange. In Latvia, you wouldn't understand what it means, but that... But you still, you looking at your young faces, you can't remember that. But in Poland, it's almost 10%. It's huge cost. So you need to look for legal advice locally, and you need to ensure or insure your debts internationally. So those are the costs that are not the part of the business if you are a local service provider. well, if you look at the share of this cost, let's skip it, but this is the most interesting finding of the research. Those cross-border costs, they amount to 29% of the total costs of labor. Now, this means that the Latvian Polish, well, in this survey, a Polish company pays 29% more for hiring a person than, and it's not net remuneration, it's extra costs, it's additional costs, indirect costs. 29%, well, how the hell are you competitive if you have such high costs, higher costs than local companies? Well, I was looking for the answers to that, and I found this research by the French Ministry of Economy and Finance, and look at the title. This is not about social dumping, this is about social competition, and I like this title much more than social dumping, and it comes from the French government. And the French government has estimated, they did what I have not done. They took only legal framework, and they've estimated the cost of hiring posted worker from another member state, actually from Spain, Poland, Portugal, and Romania, and compared it to the cost of hiring a French worker with a minimum French remuneration. And it turns out that the French worker is but the cheapest. They only compete with the Romanians. The Polish worker is more expensive to hire. The Polish posted worker, the Spanish and Portuguese posted workers are more expensive. Well, how the hell do you compete? Well, we don't. The very simple answer is that most of posting is driven by the shortage of skills in the receiving country. It is not driven by low wages. We are doing businesses there because there are no local service providers available, either at the moment or, as is the case in Belgium in the construction sector, at all. So there is no sense of saying that it is unfair competition. Without those posting companies, the building site would be empty. The two conclusions are that there are cross-border costs. I'm not sure about 29%. I must say that the sample is still too small to say with certainty that it's 29%, especially because I've run a pilot study on 5,000 PDA ones, and the result was 32%. So the larger the number, the smaller the size. But there are extra costs, and I perceive them as still barriers, economic barriers, to free movement of services. And let me just finish by telling a story. Why do you choose a foreign company? Now, we are all a little bit xenophobic and nationalistic. Let's not pretend it. I mean, I am. Okay, you can call it a patriot, economic patriot. You can call economic patriot, but usually when you choose a service company, you look at the price, you look at the quality, but the real reason is that you have to take the foreigner, even if you hate him, because there is no local provider. So in each of us, two dark forces fight against each other. One dark force is a xenophobe. I hate foreigners, I hate foreign companies, I hire only Polish. Okay? So if you post a worker from Latvia, I will not hire him. I will not hire your company because I buy Polish, okay? You can call it economic patriot. But on the other hand, in the same mind of this xenophobe, there is a greedy capitalist, Mr. Scrooge, who you can call homo economicus, who counts the costs. And he says, okay, this Polish company is 10% more expensive than the Latvian one. I will choose the Polish. If you have the difference in price, which results from the difference of wages, in order to execute your prejudice, to entertain your economic patriotism, you have to pay the price. Now, if you administratively equalize them, you will enable people to discriminate foreign companies for free. Now, do we want that? Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very, very, very much to Mario Benio. I think just a very interesting comments about this patriotism at the end. I know when I'm making reparation of my car, there is one man who is again back to the car service business in Latvia, but he used to work in UK as a small boss for employment of temporary workers in UK. But the big boss was a British, of course. And he said, if you will employ any British for temporary works, I will. You have to go. So that's an interesting point, because I think business is business for those countries, and they have to see it. And I think for the British experience, we will see soon how successful they will be in hospitality, business, and healthcare, and other things that you already described by sectors. So now we have a time for questions. We can maybe reduce a bit our coffee break if it would be a lot of questions, but so floor is yours.
Now it's question time. I think the presentations turn out to be a little bit longer than they were planned to be, but nevertheless, we can regulate our coffee break. We can shorten the coffee break. Now, please, if you have any questions, go ahead. Maybe I could start with the questions. No, there is a question from the audience, and please introduce yourself.
I come from Free Trade Union Confederation of Latvia. I'm very happy about this discussion in Latvia, so thank you very much. Thank you very much also for your academic presentation with argumentation. I'm a little bit disappointed that there is no trade unions in the panel discussion, also trade union confederation representatives. Still happy that we at least have ETUI. And if I may ask three questions to the panelists. My first question would be, actually comment, is that when we were visiting Swedish construction trade unions and construction sites, what we heard is that Latvian workers are actually very much required there, because they are very responsible, they are hardworking, and they actually have a good taste. That's why their skills are very much required, also comparing to other countries. We are proud of it. And the question is, why do you think that working at the same construction site, Latvian worker or Polish worker is less valuable than the local Swedish worker or Danish worker? And here I can find a little analogy. Like Mr. Zilli, you're probably very happy to work for the parliament, and we are proud to have you there as well. And I bet when you're working in Brussels, you are also happy to enjoy the same salary as other European Parliament deputies have there, right? Because the prices in Brussels are the same for everyone, like flight tickets, cinema tickets, local transportation, and so on. Then, yes, the panelists are right that a Latvian worker who is going to work to Western countries, he's receiving like 7 times more already than, let's say, 10 times if there would be equal pay. But still, he finds himself in this disadvantage, because he cannot have as many opportunities as his fellow colleagues from the same countries. Maybe you can comment on that. The second, I would like to ask a question about the research that the last panelist was making. We are discussing and analyzing the costs on labor, right, and how it makes our companies competitive. I wanted to ask, did you make, because you skipped that slide that was very interesting for me, about the taxation costs. because the costs of taxes, like social taxes, are still a matter of local countries. And we are, and very often, please correct me if I'm wrong, we are paying taxes not from the high minimum wage of Danish salary, but we are paying taxes, social taxes and income taxes from the local. So don't you think this is a very big actual element to compete in costs from your slide? And about the question about this last side about economic patriotism and also greedy capitalist, have you ever analyzed in your research when you were analyzing costs how much actually Eastern companies are receiving for their services? Because I never heard any numbers on that. And these services, do they actually include the local costs for labor or not? So quite interesting element I have never heard in any researches. And if this is putting our companies in disadvantage, wouldn't it be better to require the general, the big companies, the those who are ordering jobs and making Eastern companies subcontractors, just to pay more so that we can actually afford these labor costs? Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. A lot of questions. So who wants to start with Mr.
Maybe I respond to the first question and let Mr. Benio to answer the second two. So the first question, you said that when a Latvian worker is working in Sweden, he or she earns much more than at home, but a bit less than the Swedish, and you ask the question whether this is unfair, they don't have the same opportunities. But you know, I think you have to make a difference because a Swedish worker is in Sweden forever, so he has to buy a house there. If the dishwasher goes wrong, he has to call a Swedish technician to fix the dishwasher. But the Latvian worker is there for, let's say, half a year. During this half year, he receives an apartment paid by his company, where everything goes wrong, it's paid by the company, then goes back home, and when the dishwasher in her Riga home goes wrong, he calls a Latvian technician to fix that. I mean, I also have an apartment in Hungary and an apartment in Belgium, and experienced that these ordinary works are so much, the prices are so much different. So I think that this comparison is not fully fair, that with a somewhat lower pay, the Latvian is much disadvantaged because he only spends a short time there, while the Swedish worker is there forever, and therefore all higher costs in Sweden is, you know, will be there for his or her whole life.
Thank you very much for those questions. I would also like to answer the first question. Well, I agree completely with Mr. Darvas on that, but I want to be vicious in my answer and recall my example of a Bulgarian worker. Because you've mentioned, why is he less valuable than local worker? Why should he be more valuable than his colleague who stayed home? That would be the vicious answer. But of course, in your question, there is a very important factor of differences in cost of living. And that is completely true if you take into consideration a permanent migrant worker. There are two types of work migration or income migration. One is, which I call permanent migration, even though it doesn't have to be permanent. And that is the situation when the university graduate from Riga cannot find a job here, and he uses free movement of workers or free movement of persons to move to another country to look for job. And he gets a job there. And usually, because there is a difference in pay, he is better off there with his higher remuneration. And after a while, he starts thinking of importing his girlfriend there and establishing a family. And that is called talent drainage. Actually, I believe that posting of workers is a protective measure for low-wage countries which have lower level of economic development from talent draining. Because that person, and I'm not judging this person, I would do the same if I was not confined by having already a family and two children, I would probably move to another country to look for a better paid job. So that person is exercising another type of freedom. And yes, they should be treated equally. But if you are a temporary worker, and that is probably the problem. So if you exercise this second type of work migration, you come back home with some saved remuneration, some money that you've been able to save because you didn't incur those living costs, because some of them were covered by your employer. And when you come back to Latvia with a Danish remuneration, even with part of it, you are actually promoting growth of Latvian economy just by spending this money, because the purchasing power of a minimum wage in Denmark spent in Latvia is just so much higher. Therefore, the prices in Latvia go up if posting of workers gets massive. The prices in Latvia go up. So also the local workers, they start to strike and they put the pressure on their local employers to give a raise. And with time, it needs time. It's a long time process. With time, the wages go up also in Latvia. But if it's only less than 0.1% of the total labor force, that cohesion effect is not visible. It's too small. That's why I'm advocating, I'm promoting posting of workers as a cohesion tool, because you can use the same social or achieve to the same social standards two ways on the European level. One way is redistribution of welfare. So you let the high-wage countries earn more and more, you keep the low-wage countries with their low wages, and you send helping money. You use the cohesion fund to fill the gap. And that works just as social help. That makes low-wage countries vulnerable to European help. This is not the way forward. This is not the way that develops economies of those countries. That's why I see that temporary posting of, based on posting of workers, migration is better for the cohesion, for bridging the gap between low-wage countries and high-wage countries than just the social help. And just very briefly, two answers to the two other questions. The taxations and social security, yes, of course. Actually, since I'm in power here, how do they compete? This is not my research funding. This is just a hypothesis that calls for another research. But this extra 29% that they have to bear is distributed in unequal portions into remuneration. Yes, the workers earn less than local workers, if there are comparable workers, but not less than minimum rates of pay. So if the local law in the receiving country allows its own citizen to earn this money, why should the foreign citizen earn more or be forced to earn more, or their employer be forced to pay more? The second place where this 29% is distributed is the margin of the service company, which is lower for posting companies than for local service companies, if there is comparable service company. And the third place is what I love to call optimization of tax and social security. But contrary to what you said, actually, if you go to Denmark from Latvia, you pay lower taxes if you are subject of Danish tax law. Why? Because the tax-free... I would prefer to use the Polish example, because with the Polish example, I'm certain. With the Latvian, I'm not so certain. So I use the Polish example. If a Polish worker is posted for longer than 173 days in 1 year, they are subject to German tax law. And if they earn 10 euro an hour, they will pay practically no tax. Actually, taxes amounted to less than 5% of the total labor costs, whereas tax rate in Poland is 18% or 19%. How come? I was asking those employers, did you cheat on taxes? And they said, no. Our workers are actually, most of the cases, subject of German tax law, and they don't pay taxes because tax-free sum is so high compared to Poland that they don't pay taxes. If they have two children, they, on top of that, they get Kindergeld. So they, actually using the German tax law and Polish social security law is the secret to competition, yes. Yes, do we want to skip that? If we want to skip that, we need to have a unified social security system. And perhaps this is the way forward for the European Union, I have no idea. And the third question, I'm sorry.
Yes. Just a very brief comment to the first question. Indeed, there was this debate that, yeah, if you go abroad, you earn more than at home. I think in Scandinavia, in Denmark, it took a form of debate, not in terms of social dumping, but social jumping. So you indeed earn more. But indeed, much as I like the survey being really one of very few tangible elements, we still cannot claim really the representativeness of this data, as much as, you know, I would like to see this type of research being done, a representative sample. This is self-selected sample, which makes it in a way limiting, but giving us a snapshot of a certain portion of the market, this I can agree. However, for me, indeed, the problematic aspect of posting is it's general this interference of regulatory frames, which you don't have in the export-import examples of Mr. Darvas, or in the Sofia IT expert who sits at home. So, again, very difficult to regulate, and I'm not sure exactly in this or other form of the revision or how it is, but in general, something that causes problems, because locals are bound by the rules to which the service providers bringing in posted workers do not have to comply with. And this is a potential problem that is not solved, especially if the posting is systematically used and uses the cost advantages. Again, how to regulate it in a way that would be most efficient, I'm not quite sure, but indeed these examples are slightly different when it comes to the interference of regulatory frames is present in certain cases, while not that much in the others. And that is an issue, I would say. Thank you.
I will answer the difficult question about my salary, which is equal to other in Belgium. So yeah, now it's formally it's true, but I was so long in European Parliament since 2004, and between 2004 to 2009, there was a totally different system. Okay. And there was we were reimbursed our salaries on the level of national parliaments, and I was paid from Latvian Parliament. 11 times less than Italian. So now it's a rule says since 2009 that you have equal salary, of course, but you can pay more if your salaries on national parliament are higher, and Italians again have a higher employment. So at the same time, if you think this is done very, very, and it's also not fair, because I'm European Parliament builds, MEPs are not living in Brussels. They are traveling. I'm traveling every week, so then I have to be taken out for Friday, Saturday, Sunday, because I'm in Latvia. So there is less expenditures if we are going. And then we have expenditures for transportation, which again, you can imagine Benelux member who doesn't have any local, any assistant who works in Brussels, because it's good to sit in Rotterdam or Antwerpen or Luxembourg, it's easy. And you can manage much better. So your expenditures are very easy. You are paid by kilometers if you jump in your car and go home, or you will spend at least eight hours to come back from Strasbourg or to go there with a certain things. And I told about this secretariat assistance in a country of origin for MEPs. I am doing the same work as a Danish MEP in the same committee, in the same substance, and I need good support from good assistants, good advisors who can support me with a regular level. But the European Parliament rule says that you cannot pay more than a brutto two times average salary in this country. So what is that? So that's why I think until European institutions not making their own rules in a direction that if it's single market, if it's free movement, if you would like to see cohesion among member states and living standards, so let's allow to do what more freedoms, and you can expect some cohesion. So that's why, and also about the Mr. Juncker's statement, I also had in my presentation, just the one point. If the same salary in the same place, then it's meaning, in case of Latvia, where they have a lot of Scandinavian banks, and I know the banking community pretty well, there are not equal salary for Swedish banker in Riga than Latvian banker in Riga for the same position. So what we can do, we can put a tax on Swedish banker in Riga. So thank you. More questions? We still have some, yeah. Ludo?
Ilse Zviedriņa from the Ministry of Welfare, and I have some comments and some questions because we are actually dealing in our ministry with this directive and in general with the discussion as such. First, some comments. I think dumping as a terminology is more from the international trade and means selling something for less than the production costs at home. And so it's very difficult then to use this terminology. One additional thing that I think needs to be acknowledged is that Latvia has had quite an impressive convergence, and the same is true for other Eastern European countries if we compare to the situation 25 years ago, and that development as such needs time, and it means that wage convergence needs time. Then one other argument that we sometimes use is that the outcome of not allowing people to go like posted workers would be that the same people would emigrate altogether with their whole families to work in the countries there. And in Latvia, the problem is already quite acute with this migration situation. And now to the questions. So for 4 years, kind of representing the Council, so the member states, I was leading discussions of EU member states supported by the biggest, by the largest EU and Eurozone countries in the framework of the European semester on different employment-related issues. So we try to come up with a joint member state view on different issues, including on wage policies. However, recently the discussion has as well gone to issues like this European social pillar and in general, on convergence of social and unemployment systems. We have had some discussions on what could be the European social kind of values. For example, if unemployment benefit of 3 months can be considered still in the framework of the European social model and similar. However, we have never used this terminology of social dumping because Eastern Europe actually opposes to this. And in general, actually, nobody tried, so I can't really agree that it's a kind of normal terminology for policymakers because it's not really true. Of course, there is an opposite possibility to use the expression fair competition or fair internal market, but actually it could mean the same, but simply from the opposite direction. And actually, some time ago, the Baltic countries tried to get out one of such terminologies out of the document, but we didn't succeed in this. However, my question, the first question is, does all this talk of social dumping and all this fair competition, has it really the potential of solving or dealing with this issue of Europeans liking the EU more? Like one of the reasons this discussion is that, you know, maybe by talking about this problem, about inequality, about fairness, you know, the EU could improve its image, so to say, in the countries especially where there are problems with populist parties. My question is, do you believe in this? And the second question is about a bit of a pretense in those discussions. And as I mentioned before, we have had discussions on CSRs on wages, and this is mainly about about wage competition, about countries being recommended to do things so that they get more competitive. And to add to this, actually Latvia some years ago actually signed a memorandum with the European Union where the aim was to reduce the unit labor costs. So actually, this is not simply for fun, but to regain competitiveness in services and goods exports. So how do you see this? And we still have, as well, you know, the discussions that countries need to reform their wage setting framework. So how does it match with the... Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Who would like to start with the answer on those two questions? Yes, sir.
Maybe I focus on the second because I was not fully sure, I have to admit, about the first one. But on the European semester, on the memorandum of understanding for Latvia, but also Greece, which suggested improvements in unit labor costs and reforms of national wage settings, I think these are very important issues. And you know, the problem is that in a number of countries, in the pre-crisis period, wages grew much faster than productivity. And then, you know, the boom, the housing and consumption and construction boom was ongoing. It didn't really cause a problem. But when the crisis hit, then it revealed that there are major problems, misaligned wages and productivity in a number of countries. And certainly these countries face difficulties in adjusting. At the same time, especially the southern European countries like Greece, Spain and Portugal, they accumulated really huge foreign debt. And, you know, servicing the foreign debt is very costly. I mean, in these countries, foreign debt amounts to about 100% of GDP. And to service foreign debt, you have to sell more products and services abroad. And in debt, certainly there are many price and non-price aspects, but also, you know, unit labor costs is one aspect. Or I can mention Italy, you know, where, you know, wages are just growing and growing and growing, you know, steadily, well over productivity. clearly, I think there are problems with the wage setting mechanism. So I welcome the efforts of the Commission to try to analyze and understand better how wages are formed in countries. And when they see a problem, then they make proposals in these country-specific recommendations.
And on the first question, is anybody who wants to react or
two things, I guess. One, indeed, the revision, and it is still quite a very divisive issue, but divisive in two different ways, I would say. So as much as in the West, the discussion is if there is nothing done, you remember Marek at the conference that we attended at the parliament, if there is nothing done, then there will be unrest caused by general disappointment with lack of fight with blatant abuses of employee conditions. In the East, there is a different type of argumentation. You know, these are new barriers or the barriers of on the Oder River, or, you know. So it is, in a way, a divisive issue, but any of the solution will not be happy for either of the sides. So it's divisive in ways that are very, very difficult to reconcile. But I think, in a way, how this could improve or where the common denominator can be found is really a fight with the blatant abuses. And in this, I see only not only the role of national authorities, but also social partners, trade unions, but also employer associations that are aware. And I was actually very nicely surprised at the beginning of my contact with Marek, because their association approached me and asked, so which are the biggest problems with posting? We want to know, because we want to ask, act against them. And I think this is really the platform in which social partners' activities are very important, and signaling the black sheep in the family can really unite the two sides. And in this way, perhaps, we could find a way forward. That's what I would suggest.
Yeah, well, thank you. I think with this remarks, we have to close our first panel. Now we have a coffee break. We are a bit behind our timetable. Let's start again at 20 to 1, 18 minutes coffee break. Thank you.